be seated.
Grace to you, peace be multiplied to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks for coming out and worshiping with us this morning here at Beacon Hill Church. My name is Michael Moore, and I have the privilege of serving as pastor of this wonderful fellowship of believers. If I have a chance, yes, thank you. If I haven't got a chance to meet you yet, if you're a guest with us today, just stop by. I'll be right outside those doors. I'd love to get a chance to shake your hand. Just thank you for coming to see how we can minister to you here at Beacon Hill Church. Here at Beacon Hill, we go right through the Bible. We go through books of the Bible, just going verse by verse. And currently, we're in John chapter 12. And so, if you don't have, it's preacher time, by the way, so grab your Bible and get it out, all right? We won't do that right now. If you don't have a copy of God's Word with you today, just raise your hand and one of our Beacon Hill team members will bring you a copy of God's Word. If you'd also like a copy of today's sermon, every week I print them out. I actually email them out on Saturday. Just raise your hand and they will get one into your hands as well. Also, hey, look, we are blessed, but we have a lot of new believers here at Beacon Hill Church. Man, God is doing a work in our midst. We're seeing people come to Christ on a regular basis. And I just want to thank you for your commitment of being here. And if you have any questions at any time about the Word of God, something we can help you grow, we want to walk beside you and help you grow in your knowledge of the Word of God, feel free to give me a call. My phone number is literally posted on everything that we have. Make sure you give me a call anytime between midnight and 5 a.m. Call Ryan Jenkins, and I will give you his phone number as well. So whatever we can do to help you out, I'm all there for you, bro. Appreciate you, all right? So look, we've already had enough excitement. Usually I ask you to stand for the reading of the Word of God, but in the Bible, both were done, and I've had enough excitement with people standing today, so let's stay seated as I read the Word of God this morning. John chapter 12, verses 1 through 11. Well, we're going to do the first 11 verses this morning. The Word of God says this: 6 days before the Passover, Jesus therefore came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So they gave a dinner for him there. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at the table. Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume, but Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, he who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Jesus says, "Leave her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me." When the large crowd of the Jews learned that Jesus was there, they came not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. Let us pray. Dearly Father, I thank you and I praise you for your word. I thank you for the power of your word to save. Lord, it's just an amazing blessing that we have to have your word and be able to preach your word this morning. So Lord, I pray that you would be with me this morning, that I would preach your word with conviction, with clarity of mind, that you would get anything out of my mind that is not from you. And Lord, just focus on the proclamation of the word. Lord, give me the boldness and the courage just to proclaim it as I ought. Lord, be with the hearers today. Lord, people came from a lot of different places, not just location-wise, but spiritually and life events to be here this morning at the Beacon Theater. So, Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit would speak to the hearts of the hearers, and Lord, that we would be moved to action this morning. Lord, I pray that if someone is here today that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, that today would be the day of salvation for them. Lord, may I decrease now and you increase as I proclaim your word. In Jesus' holy and precious name we praise you. Amen. I have entitled today's message, "Not Your Typical Dinner Party." Not your typical dinner party. In our text this morning, we see where Jesus is coming back to Bethany, the place where he raised raised Lazarus from the dead, and they were having a dinner party in his honor. Now we have, actually, if you've been around here any length of time, we have this thing called community groups. It is literally, we start off having a dinner party three times a week, on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday. It's a traditional dinner party. People a lot of times bring different side dishes. There's a main dish, and we stick around for an hour before we get into the Word, just getting to know each other and draw closer to the Word. We have typical dinner parties three times a week here at this church. That's what Acts 2:42-47 tells us to do. Yet this dinner party that is being discussed in this text was anything but typical. We often, in my community group, we often send out an invite list to say, hey, accept and decline, and you can see who's coming to the party and who's not. But imagine when you look down the list, if a couple of these names were on the invite list to say they were coming. Imagine if Lazarus or Jesus or Judas was on the list. I would imagine that it would change the scope and the focus of your dinner party. Look, imagine Lazarus was at a dinner party that you were throwing. I mean, not just Lazarus, anybody who has ever you watched die, be put in the tomb, literally 4 days later, he gets called out from the tomb. He takes the linen cloth off of him, and he is sitting at your dinner table. That is not normal, church. That does not happen. I would have one question when you ask Lazarus. I mean, do you think you would have said, were you really dead? Did you go to heaven? Literally, I mean, would you have just a lot? I imagine that Lazarus would be fielding a lot of the questions here at this dinner party. And then we have this guy named Judas. Now, to be fair, at the time of the dinner party, we don't realize what an important person and role that he would fill in history, right? We didn't understand, I mean, that scripture tells us now, looking back, that he would be the one who would betray Jesus. Now, his actions at the dinner party might be something that we'll talk about, and people might have opinions about him, but we certainly didn't understand what Judas would be doing there. And then we also have Jesus there, right? Matter of fact, the party was in his honor. Everyone came because Jesus was going to be there. Now, to be fair, not everyone knew Jesus was Lord. They knew he was a miracle worker. They saw Jesus bring Lazarus back from the dead, but a lot of people did not understand the significance of who they had at their dinner table. Yet, there's this one lady who is at the party, who is not seated at the table, that I want to talk to you about this morning, and it's this lady named Mary. I want to talk to you about the actions of Mary that were so significant that has made a lasting impact on the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is my first point this morning. Make a lasting impact for the gospel of Jesus Christ. This dinner party is so important. This dinner party is so important that it is talked about in all four gospels. You might see a story in one gospel, occasionally in two, very rarely three, but you do not see Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John tell about the same story. This story, this dinner party, was so important in history that not only was it discussed in all four gospels, this dinner party is still being talked about 2,000 years later. Church family, I want to ask you this morning, is what you are doing for the kingdom of God so important that it will outlast you? Mary had no clue her actions that day would be talked about 2,000 years later. She just wanted to serve Jesus faithfully, lovingly, completely, and obediently. I'm here today to tell you that when you focus not on yourself, but on Jesus, you can be a kingdom impact person. What we are doing here at Beacon Hill Church is not for our glory, it is for the glory of the Lord. I could care less if 2,000 years from now, matter of fact, I could care less if 30 years from now, if anybody ever remembered that I was the pastor of this church. I could care less in 2,000 years from now, should the Lord tarry, that anybody would even know the name of Beacon Hill Church. But we would be blessed. We would be blessed beyond measure if there are stories being written about the revival that started in Hopewell, Virginia, in this place in 2008. I want us to look beyond what you think you're capable of. I want you to look beyond what this church is capable of. I want you to look beyond what even all the churches partnering together are capable of. I want you to say, Jesus, I want to see a mighty work in this place. Use me for your glory. We have gotten so complacent in the American church. We've gotten so complacent, we've gotten so apathetic that we don't even understand what it's like to see the movement of the Holy Spirit anymore. But I want you to know that the God of the Bible is the same God that we have today. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Make a lasting impact for the gospel of Jesus Christ. On February 3rd, 1970, students from a small college named Asbury in the town of Wilmore gathered for another one of their required weekly chapel meetings. When I was at Chowan College, we weren't exactly the most devout college in the world, but we were a Christian college, and we had chapel meetings that we had to go to twice a year. Well, if you've been to Liberty, any Liberty students here, they have chapel meetings that are literally twice a week that you're required to go to. And here at Asbury College, it was no different. They had three times a week, they had a required 50-minute chapel service that they were to go to. They walked in, the students had their name checked off, that they were in attendance. It was just another one of their duties that they had to do as a student of Asbury College. Matter of fact, I don't know how many of you grew up and remember the old envelopes for offering. Matter of fact, we have offering envelopes, and it's you put money in there and you put an offering plate. That's another story. But look, we have offering envelopes, and when I was growing up, it used to say present, and you check mark. Anybody remembers this? Anybody remember this? And it says Bible brought, right? I mean, it was like a check mark to make sure you were following the list of rules and regulations, right? And unfortunately, that's really how a lot of us treat church today. We treat it as a duty and not a devotion, right? We treat it as something that we must do instead of something that we get to do. But on this day, people were coming to Asbury College for another typical day, another 50-minute check mark. And quite frankly, they were hoping to get out of there and on their way. There was nothing special about this day. And even so much that the president was out of town, it's kind of like when the preacher is out of town a lot of times, now all of a sudden people have their schedules booked up for the next Sunday, you know what I'm saying? The president was out of town. The academic dean didn't even speak on this particular day. They had one person came up and gave their testimony, and I want you to know that some people use the term all hell broke loose. I want you to know that all heaven broke loose this day. And it was an amazing thing. This 50-minute chapel service didn't just go a little over. It didn't go to just, matter of fact, you know, I know as a preacher, when I say in closing, a lot of times I hear the zippers on the Bibles, and I hear the loudness of the Bible shutting being more than the word of God that is being spoken. Look, on this day at Asbury College, not only did it go over 50 minutes, it went over 60 minutes, it went over an hour, check with me now, it went 154 consecutive hours, 24 hours a day, it didn't stop and people didn't leave. In fact, so many people were coming into the chapel service that they had to move it to the biggest place on campus. This is the days before social media, before you had cell phones, yet the revival that was taking place in this place, in Asbury College, was so impactful that it went from New York to California and even to South America. When it was done, it had reached more than 130 colleges, and they are still talking about it today. Look, church family, Leonard Ravenhill once said that one day some simple soul is going to pick up the Bible, believe it, and put the rest of us to shame. Believe in Jesus Christ. Believe in the power of Jesus Christ. Serve him faithfully and with all your heart. And I tell you what, we will see a revival in this place like they have never seen before. I want you to see just some simple acts of devotion that Mary did. Because when we look at what Mary did, we can see what it's going to take to see a revival start in your hearts that will make a kingdom impact that will outlast you. The first thing I want you to see from verse 3 is the selfless devotion of Mary.
Scripture says, Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume.
You know, the thing that she did that made such a lasting impact is she took this jar of perfume, this nard, all right? We call it perfume, men call it cologne. It was very expensive what she was doing. She poured it on his feet and wiped her hair with his feet. And I want you to see one of the first things, the cost involved in what she was doing. Look, so many of us, who's bought perfume here or cologne? You know how expensive that stuff is? It's crazy, man, just for a little bit, right? And we see that, in fact, the amount that Mary was using that day was so expensive that they said it was a year's wages. I mean, this was a lot of perfume that she was pouring on Jesus' feet. I remember when I was courting my wife, I've told stories about that before, but man, I loved my wife for the first time that I saw her. And I mean, I set up this date, right? I mean, I cooked a three-course meal, mashed potatoes. I made this stuff, right? And I went to Walmart and bought a tablecloth and didn't fit the whole table, but I wanted to impress her. Ain't nothing better than Walmart tablecloth, right? So we get down there, and I even had a friend of mine named Todd Resnick who made a mixtape, right, of, complete with Marvin Gaye and everything. And I mean, I wanted to make myself irresistible to my wife, you know what I'm saying? And the only thing that I could think of to top it off was to get myself some cologne that made myself irresistible. I needed some eau de toilette, if you know what I'm saying, right? I mean, I wanted to go in there, and I went in there and I said, look, I want something here today that would just make me just irresistible. Like, and I saw this bottle of Obsession by Calvin Klein. And I said, you know what? That will do it right there, man. I said, give it that right there, man. And then she told me the cost. And I'm like, do you have something that will make her go on a second date with me? Because I can't afford what was being brought here. Look, when you start understanding that regardless of the wealth of Mary, the cost involved in what she was doing, it was an act of selfless devotion that she was doing. You know, too many of us, when we come to serving Jesus, we count the cost of our pocketbook instead of the cost of following him. So we need to understand the cost involved in following Jesus. As C.T. Studd once said, if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, there is no sacrifice too great for me to make for him. Do you count the cost of what you're doing in following Jesus? Mary decided that whatever she had, whatever she could give to Jesus, was worth it. Marriage showed cost didn't matter. May we look at what we give to the Lord, how we serve the Lord, and see if we consider him our master or our butler, church family. Second thing I want you to see about Mary, not only her selfless devotion, but there's two things that she did that showed just an amazing amount of humility. When we look at scripture here, a typical woman, and women back in those days were not well thought of. And so they tried to stay out the way as much as possible. And women had to keep their bun, their hair in a bun. Literally, you couldn't let your hair down. Matter of fact, if you were seen with your hair down, you were considered a loose woman. People thought that you were easy, and this was something that would open you up to being mocked and being ridiculed. And yet, Mary did not care about anything about that. She didn't care what other people thought of her. She didn't care. She didn't worry about how much something cost. She didn't care about what was the societal norm. She didn't care about what people thought of her. She just wanted to honor Jesus with her life. Look, church family, when loving and honoring Jesus means more to you than anything else, you can make a kingdom impact. There's nothing that you can do for the Lord that is too insignificant if your heart's in it for the right reasons. The other thing that she did, not only did she let her hair down, she took her hair and she wiped his feet with it. I don't think we appreciate that. Look, back in these days, touching somebody's feet was the lowest of low. It was the most degrading thing that you could do. Yet she lovingly wiped his feet with her hair. And this is something that, I want you to just really, really, we talked about doing something that is outlasting even you. The scripture says that there was a sweet fragrance in the air. You know, that means that even after the dinner party was over, there was a sweet smell of her selfless devotion that filled the whole room. Do you know when you are just serving Jesus out of selfless devotion for the right reason, people will talk about what you did for Jesus well beyond this hour and well beyond your season.
Yes, yes.
Do it for the right reasons. Secondly, I want you to see her unwavering commitment. This is what scripture says in verses 4 through 6. When Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" He said, "This is not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put in it." You know, Mary took her perfume with her money and did what she thought best served the Lord with it. And instead of being received with accolades, she was received with rejection and ridicule with what they thought she could do better with the money. In fact, he said, "Why was this not sold and given to the poor?" He even had a suggestion of what she should have done with the money. He didn't say this because he cared about the poor, but because he wanted to serve his own pockets. See, the crowd on the outside saw a disciple of Jesus because they didn't know that he was the betrayer yet. They saw somebody who was faithful in the church on the outside making a legitimate question about the use of the money that Mary had spent on the feet of Jesus. But Jesus knew the heart of this disciple on the inside. He was a thief, he was a betrayer, and he was the one who would call Jesus to go to the cross. I take that back. He didn't call Jesus because it was in the Bible and it was going to happen with or without Judas. Here we go. There are a lot of Judases in this church today, ones who appear to be disciples of Jesus but are really enemies of the cross. Do you understand with me? A lot of people want to sit there and say what you should be doing for Jesus while they do nothing for Jesus. I'm here to tell you that when I first wanted to go to Martinique for the first time, God had called me to go to Martinique. I prayed. I went over 3,000 people groups in this world who didn't know Jesus Christ as Lord of their lives. And I said, "God, send me to Martinique." And I got to tell you, I got ridicule. I got sidebar conversations. I got pastor. We can do a lot more with that $1,000 here in this town than we can do to send you over there. And I got news for you. The gospel is bigger than Hopewell, Virginia Christ. Jesus Christ did not just die for some, he died for all. So I flew out to Martinique, and on one of those trips, you know, 100 people were saved. I just say that's a pretty good return on investment. But stay with me here. It was a French-speaking country. I didn't know what was going on. I had a translator. After I was done, I'm tired. I was sitting in the corner, and then they started offering. And they were taking it, and the way they do it, they are excited to give to Jesus in Martinique. They took this basket and they put it up right in front and they played a song and people danced down the aisles and they come and put the money into the offering plate. And it went on, and it was exciting. And I gotta tell you, there's something that happened that just made me cringe. I wish I had time to share with you, but it was just something to watch this offering. And then when they were done with the offering, and I was like, "Man, praise God, you're doing something, you know, they're just doing great work here." The pastor turned around and gave me all the money which paid for my trip to start with. Do you know you can't outgive God? I mean, when you're serving Jesus for the right reasons, you can't outgive him. You can't outserve him. People will say there are people right here that need help. Why are you going to Haiti next week? Well, I'll tell you what, while I'm in Haiti next week, you tell people about Jesus here at Hopewell next week. In the words of the great theologian Taylor Swift, "Hate is going to hate. You just keep on preaching Jesus Christ." If you are called to God by a ministry, don't be swayed with what the world says or people in the church says. You keep serving Jesus, and you know that you're doing it for the right reasons. And look, here we go. We're making a beeline for the cross this morning. If you haven't heard about the cross, you're going to hear about it here in a second. Verses 7 through 9, he looked forward to the cross. Jesus says, "Leave her alone.
so that no one else stood up for her. No one else said, let her do what she called to do. But Jesus stood up for you. And I got to tell you, if no one else will stand up for you, no one else will come alongside of you, you got the best advocate that I know in Jesus Christ. And he sat here. He said, leave her alone so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you don't always have me. For the poor you always have with you, but you don't always have me. When the large crowd of Jews learned that Jesus was there, they came not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. This passage begins the final week of Jesus' life. What we're going to be studying for the months to come is going to make a beeline to the cross. Every passage builds on the previous passage as we go to the day that Jesus Christ would give his life on the cross. The reason that he came down from heaven, he was born of a virgin, he lived a sinless life. He died the death that we deserve to die for us so that we can live. He was put on that tomb and he was buried, but on the third day he conquered the grave. And church family, he's coming back again. What we start here is making a beeline for the cross. What we're doing at Beacon Hill Church is making a beeline for the cross. May everything that we do with this church have the kingdom in mind and bring as many people with us as possible. You understand what I'm saying? Look, Jesus knew what he was doing. Jesus knew the heart of Mary and that she was doing it for the right reasons. Church family, has been a long time since the people of Hopewell have seen a true movement of Jesus Christ in this town. I will tell you that if you are selflessly devoted to him and you do it with unwavering commitment, we will see a revival in this town that is still being talked about 2,000 years from now. I want to close with this and then a couple of points afterwards. Serving Jesus was never meant to be easy, church. Verse 11. The chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. This is probably one of my favorite parts, man. It's so crazy, right? I mean, Jesus was the one who delivered Lazarus from the tomb. Mary was the one who was all the commotion. And there's this guy who was just brought back from the dead, who was just trying to enjoy a meal, and now they're trying to kill him. It's like, what did I do here? I didn't do that before. I'm just sitting here. I didn't even ask to be brought back to life. Jesus did this for his glory, and now you want to try to kill me? Look, I got to tell you, when you serve Jesus Christ, people will come after you in different ways. The devil doesn't like you stepping out for Jesus Christ. You're going to be a byproduct of what is happening in the spirit. Serving Jesus was never meant to be easy. When he says, come and follow me, he doesn't say, think about it. He says, come and follow me. He says, who is my mother? Who is my father? Leave, let the dead bury their dead, and come and follow me. Serving Jesus was meant to come with the cost. Have you counted the cost and followed him? And have you determined what I already know? It is worth it, church family. Yeah. It is worth it. Yeah. I want to leave you with 5 points, and if you can just literally jot these down, or I could send you the sermon. Some of these I got from a dear brother of mine. Some of these that I just think they're all good. Look, number one, true love is best observed and not explained. Now, we can sit here and talk about how much we love Jesus, but it's another thing to go out there and show the world how much we do love him. It's another thing to put our faith into action. And if we become radical in our devotion for Christ, even our close friends will not understand what we're doing. Do you get that? If you sit there and say, you know what, I'm going to start tithing, I'm going to go on a mission trip, I'm going to give to this, your close friends, even your spouse, will not understand what you're doing. Number three, if my life for Jesus never leads me to get uncomfortable for him, how much do I really love him? Number four, there are moments in our life where we must follow Jesus even when no one else will. And number five, we ought not to criticize those who follow Jesus in a different way than us. So I ask you this morning, who's ready to join this radical journey? Who's ready to just lay down their life and say, look, I want to be that person. I don't want to do it for my glory, but I want to be used to see revival in this town. that is talked about way past my lifetime. I don't care if they ever know who I am, but I want this town to know who Jesus Christ is and that Jesus Christ came and gave his life so not only that I can live, but you can live and everyone in this town who can live who repents of their sin and trust in him as Lord of their life. Are you ready to start that radical journey with the church?
Yes.
Look, I want to pray and I'm going to ask you to respond today. Maybe you're sitting there and you've been on the fence and you're like, I don't know, maybe I don't know if I joined this church. And we got a lot of things that are happening. Look, I'm just saying lay it down today. Maybe you've never turned your life over to Jesus. Lay your life. I can tell you what, Jesus Christ can do more with your life in a minute than you can do in your own lifetime. Give it to him. I'm going to ask you to respond after I pray. Dear Father, I thank you and I praise you for who you are. I thank you for being a God who saves, a God who loves us. Lord, to see Mary just have that type of commitment, Lord, knowing that she would be ridiculed, knowing that it was not the norm, knowing that so many people would say something, and yet she didn't care because she knew that Jesus Christ was greater than anything the world could throw at her. Lord, I pray that we would be serious about serving you. Lord, we just want to talk about it. We would live it out. Lord, we have people today that are leaving and going places that we may never see them again till we get to heaven. Lord, may you use them in a mighty way when they're going for your glory. Lord, I thank you and I praise you that we have a God who loves us and a God who sent his son to die for us so that we could be with you for eternity. Lord, if someone is here today who doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, may the day be the day of salvation for them. And God's holy and precious name we praise you. Amen. Please stand, prayer team, come forth, and we respond to the word of God this morning.